afternoon all, welcome to today's SAP online class. Today's session is for electrical and electronics engineering students, semester 4, subject synchronous and induction machines, module 5, topic test on induction motors for determination of equivalent circuit. Today's session will be of 1 hour. After the first 20 minutes, we will open for Q&A, where you can ask the questions about the first 20-minute session, and at the end of the session, towards the end of the session also, we'll be addressing the questions you have. So kindly type your questions in the Q&A session. For handling today's session, we have Ms. Srikala ma'am, Assistant Professor, Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering, Amal Jyothi College of Engineering, Kottayam. She did her BTech from RIT Kottayam and MTech from Amal Jyothi, and she's pursuing her PhD. She has a total experience of 15 years. She has published more than 20 papers in international conference publications and 4 papers in Scopus Index paper publication. She has been awarded the best paper awardee. And it's a pleasure you are here with us, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you, Swati.
Good afternoon, students. Today, we are going to the topic, the test on induction motor for the determination of equivalent circuit.
So before going to the topic, this topic is another module. And before start the topic, we are just to discuss about the what is induction motor. So induction motor is an asynchronous motor, and it is also called a rotating transformer. The working principle of the induction motor is the Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. The characteristics of this machine is almost same as that of the transformer, but the small difference is this is a rotating machine and the transformer is a stationary machine. By definition, the induction motor is an AC motor in which the electric current in the rotor needed to produce torque is obtained by electromagnetic induction from the magnetic field of stator winding. That means the current in the rotor resulted from an induced voltage. That means some magnetic field in the stator, and that magnetic field is interacted with the rotor. The rotor is a short circuited conductor, and that will carry a current. And that due to that current, an EMF is induced in the rotor. Hence the name induction motor. The induction motor means the current in the rotor a result from an induced voltage, hence the name, this machine is called induction motor. And based on the rotor construction, the induction motors are mainly classified into two. The first one is the squirrel gate induction motor, and the second one is slip ring induction motor. So this is a basic information about the three-phase induction motor. So the detailed description of squirrel gauge induction motor, constructional description about the squirrel gauge induction motor, the wound rotor induction motor, that is the slip ring induction motor, is already studied in the fourth module. So now we are going to the next topic, is how to determine the equivalent circuit of three-phase induction motor. Then what is equivalent circuit? Equivalent circuit means the electrical representation of a machine. So the machine is physically available, and then its working is Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, but its equivalent representation of in using electrical symbols. So this machine consisting of the resistance, inductance, etc. So the same machine is converted to the equivalent of that is called the equivalent circuit. In an induction motor, So calculating the equivalent circuit parameter, we want to conduct three tests. The first test is the determination of stator resistance. The determination of stator resistance means the stator means the armature, that is the winding, three phase winding, and how to determine the resistance of the armature or stator. So here we are using a voltmeter and ammeter method for calculating the stator resistance. And the second one is the no load test. The no load test of a three phase induction motor is same as that of the no load test of a transformer. And the last one is the blocked rotor test. And this blocked rotor test is same as that of the short circuit test of a transformer. The last two tests are almost same as that of the transformer test. And next, how to determine the stator resistance. So this is the connection diagram of stator resistance measurement. And before that, first we are assuming that the stator is star connected one. We can connect the voltmeter, ammeter and a DC source across the stator winding in any one of these two methods. The circuit diagram, these two circuit diagrams are shown here. The first one is you are connecting the DC source and voltmeter across the two phases, and the second one we are connecting DC source and the voltmeter across a single phase, that means one phase and a neutral. Here in the first diagram, the DC source is applied across R and Y phases. The voltmeter is also connected across the ammeter, connected in series with the R phase, and the third phase B is kept open. There is no connection with the other two phases. Then the total voltage of V is applied. So without the effect of phase B, R and Y are in series. So now R phase and Y phase are connected in series, right? Then the total voltage is divided into two. That is, one part is across the first R phase and the second part is across the Y phase. That means the voltage across R and Y, that is the sum of voltage across R and Y, is equal to the total input voltage. That is the total input DC voltage. Here RDC is the resistance of R phase. R phase means the per phase resistance is R phase, RDC, and the Y phase resistance is again RDC. B phase resistance is again next RDC. So now we are connecting the DC voltage across R and Y, and now I already told you R phase and Y phases are connected in series, right? Now what is the total resistance? The RDC plus RDC, it is 2 RDC. So 2 RDC resistance is there, and what is the voltage across the resistance? That will be given by this voltmeter V. It is connected across the R and Y phase, right? And now we get voltage, and current is measured by using an ammeter. So in the last portion, we are writing the equation 2 RDC. Then how will you get the 2 RDC? So this 2 RDC is obtained by adding the R phase resistance and the Y phase resistance, and that is equal to the ratio of voltage and current, that is V by I. So now we want pulse phase resistance. That means we want a resistance of a single phase, either R phase, Y phase, or B phase. So then the single per phase resistance is RDC is equal to V by 2I. V by 2I. Okay, so that will write at the last portion. So then next one is the same experiment, and we are connecting this voltage across the R phase and neutral phase. So R and neutral, and then we can write the resistance equation directly. That means we in this case only one phase is connected across the voltmeter and the DC source, and here we get the volt resistance of a single phase directly, that is RDC, and that RDC is equal to V by I. So now we get all the values of resistances are in DC. Now this machine is an AC convert that DC equivalent resistance into AC. So that will convert it by multiplying the DC resistance with a constant 1.25. Okay, so now we get the AC resistance of RAC. RAC means this is the stator per phase resistance. So normally it is written as a small letter R1, right? So then so this is about the measurement of the DC the stator resistance by voltmeter ammeter method. So then the rotor or stator resistance is measured, and the value of stator resistance is R1. Okay, any doubt? Any doubt? Actually, the circuit diagram. This is a basic diagram, and in your lab sections, you are already shown the circuit diagram, including one resistance in the R phase connected in series, and one DC source is there. And normally we are using a 220 volt DC supply, and the 220 volt DC supply is used for measuring the resistance, and then we are definitely put one resistance in series. Okay, because the armature or a stator resistance is very small, so then we are using one rheostat in series, right? And this is a voltmeter, ammeter, and the winding connection. So then the remaining one is one rheostat is there and one DC source is there. That is not included in this diagram. Clear, Muhammad? Okay. Any doubt? The next topic is the second experiment, that is the equivalent circuit parameter calculation. The second experiment is the no load test. In the no load test, This is the circuit diagram for the no load test. So then this is same as that of the no load test of a transformer. This is same as that of the no load test of a transformer. So then in a three phase induction motor, the voltmeter is connected across the two phases. Ammeter is connected like in series with the R phase or any one of the phase. And power measurement using two wattmeter method. And before the circuit explanation, some procedures are there. The first one is, I already told you this test is similar to that of the open circuit test of a transformer. Now, the machine is run at the no load condition at the rated voltage and frequency. The rated voltage and frequency means the machine is run at the rated speed, that is the synchronous speed, and not the synchronous speed. It's wrong. It is the machine is run at the rotor speed, the rated rotor speed. The motor is no load at the rated voltage and frequency. Then, so then the rated voltage is applied here, and there is no load is connected to the machine. So machine is at a condition, and the rated voltage is applied. Then voltmeter, ammeter, and the two wattmeter readings are noted. And this wattmeter reading gives the total losses of the machine, three phase induction machine. So that means it is a sum of copper losses in the stator winding. That means the wattmeter reading. Wattmeter, two wattmeter reading is copper losses in the stator winding, copper losses in the rotor winding, iron losses in the stator winding, iron losses in the rotor core, and the friction and windage losses. The second and the fourth one is very negligible, so then we can eliminate that one. That means the rotor copper loss at the rotor winding, iron losses in the rotor core, because these two are depends on the slip frequency. Slip frequency means if the frequency is very small, so then we can eliminate the second and the fourth losses. The third and fifth loss is collectively called the constant loss. Iron losses in the stator core and friction and windage losses are collectively called what? It is a constant loss. So here in our diagram, for measuring the power, we are using a low power factor meter, low power factor wattmeter, that is LPF wattmeter. Then what is the use of LPS wattmeter? LPF low power factor wattmeter. In our induction machine is at a no load, so the machine is in no load condition, its power factor is less than 0.5. Its power factor is less than 0.5. Then what is the total power equation? It is the product of voltage, current and power factor. Suppose example, our power is a three phase power and the voltmeter reading is 100 volt and current is 2 ampere and the power factor is 0.2. And what is the total power? What is the total power? What is the total power? 20 into 2, 40. 40 into 3 is 120. It is 120 watts. Again, the value of power factor is increased. So now the power factor is increased to 0.3. Then what is the power? 300 into 2. 300 into 2 is 600. 600 into 2 is 120. Again, 600 into 3. It is 180. Okay. Again, the power factor is increased to 2.4. Then power factor increased. Then the total power, active power increased. So then, in the case of an LPF wattmeter, or suppose we are using a UPF wattmeter for measuring the power in no load test. So then, what is the difficulty we are facing? So here, in a UPF meter, its dial is start from, it is 100 or more than 100. So we cannot measure the low power. So for measuring this low power, we are using an LPF wattmeter. So for that, in a no load test, we are using an LPF wattmeter. So now we get the total power W1 plus W2, then voltage. Voltmeter reading gives the voltage, the rated voltage, and ammeter gives the no load current. And the total power obtained from the wattmeters are classified like this. So that is a 1 to 5. Out of that, this the second and the fourth one is negligible. That means it depends on the frequency. And the fifth one is collectively called the constant power, right? So from this experiment and all of the details, we are calculating the two constants R0 and X0. So any doubt in explaining this circuit diagram? Students, any doubt?
Ma'am, we have a question.
Yeah.
What are the aim of the no load and load tests?
Aim.
Yes.
So then the answer is to find that is the last point. The constants R0 and X0 of the X equivalent circuit can be calculated. So the aim of the no load is to find the circuit parameters such as R0 and X0. The magnetizing component and the working component of three-phase induction motor can be calculated by conducting this no load test. Any other doubt?
Why LPF meter for no load test?
Yeah, in an LPF meter, it is they already told you this LPF meter means it's a low power factor meter. So in a low power factor meter means it is mainly used to measure the power at a low power factor range. So at a no load condition, there is no load is connected to the three phase induction motor, and then the machine is run at a no load condition. Okay. So then in a no load condition, the power factor of a three phase induction motor is always less than 0.5. That means cos phi is equal to 0.5. Then the power equation is three phase power equation, either root 3 VL IL cos phi, or it is 3 V phase I phase cos phi. So the cos phi is depends on the quality of power. Then cos phi is less means its quality decreases. So now the machine is no load. In that condition, so then already I explained one example. The power, three phase power is, and power equation, the voltage is equal to 100. And the ammeter reading is 2, and suppose the power factor is 0.2, then the total power is 120 watts. 3 into 3 phase power. 3 into 100 into 2 into 0.2, directly multiply. So then we get 120. Again, change the cosine value. 0.2 is changed from 0.2 to 0.3. Then the power is increased from 120 to 180. So from that reading, we can find out this power factor increases, power quality increases. Right. Any doubt? So for measuring that one, we are using low power factor meter. So in a unity power factor meter dial, then it is start from 100, 200 up to in that range. It is not directly visible. So for easy measurement, we are using a low power factor wattmeter. It is calibrated in a low range. So any other doubt?
Why the power factor of induction machine is less than 0.5 in no load?
So actually, the power factor of any machine is decided by this load. So now at no load condition, the machine is run with some internal resistance and the internal inductance, etc. Without any load. So the some load is added, so then the power factor increases. In a any condition in power system or electrical machine, in any case, the power factor is decided by its load. Okay, clear?
Okay, ma'am. That's all.
Okay, one question is here. Why iron losses occur due to frequency? Then iron losses means it is the eddy losses, sum of eddy current losses and hysteresis loss. The eddy current loss and hysteresis losses are directly proportional to the frequency. The frequency varies, then proportionally the losses varies. The W is the eddy current loss directly proportional to S square. So then the frequency is one part. In one part, the losses is decided by the frequency. Then explain the constant losses. Then the constant loss means, one question from Faresh. So then the constant loss means, there is no change when the load is increased or decreases at a no load condition, half load condition, or a full load condition, whatever it is. So this load is constant. So that constant, first one, it is the stator core loss. The stator core loss means it is a stator material. So which material is used for making this rotor? So then the losses in that area, it is a fixed one. And the friction and windage losses. Then frictional loss. Friction loss means the rotating machine produces some losses. So that is considered as a constant loss. And windage losses. So the machine is rotating. The wind flow opposes their rotation. Okay. So then again it is produces some losses, not a windage loss. Majority of them are because there is no windage loss. So the flow of air is there due to the non-driving side, then fan is there, and then due to that some losses is occur in the machine. So in that sense, it is stator core loss and friction and windage loss are called as constant loss. Okay, one more question by using 2 wattmeter in the circuit. So we can use the 2 wattmeter method and 1 wattmeter method. So then the power measurement using the two wattmeter method, single wattmeter method, everything you already studied in a measurements topics. Then here we are using a, instead of a two wattmeter method, we can use a single wattmeter. So then here the in the circuit one changes in the wattmeter. Pressure coil is connected to the neutral terminal, not connected to the other terminal. It is connected to the neutral. So we can use a single wattmeter or a two wattmeter. Any method we can adopt. Amel. Okay. So then the power measurement using wattmeter method, power measure already studied in the measurements classes. So I think your current semester, do you have any measurements paper? So then it's studied in the two wattmeter method. Otherwise we can use it a single wattmeter. Current coil is connected in series, there's no change. But the resistance part, that coil is called a pressure coil, the voltage coil. And one end is connected to any one of the phase, that here it is connected to our phase and another end terminal is connected to the neutral. So then we can measure only one phase power. Then for three phase, it is multiplied with the three. Clear? Ajmal? Okay. Any other doubt?
And there is one more question. How will you separate hysteresis and eddy current losses for the total iron loss?
How will you
separate hysteresis and eddy current losses for the total iron loss?
Okay, so that part will discuss the later, because it is one graph is first we can draw the graph, and from that graph we can separate this hysteresis and the process. So one class is required for taking the that particular topic.
Okay, ma'am.
Any doubt?
There is no more questions pending, ma'am. You can carry on.
Okay. Next is this is the reactor setup and the procedure. Then next is how will you get the value of R0 and X0? Okay. So here this voltmeter reading, and the voltmeter is connected across the two phases. We are called the phases, and voltage across the two phases is called a line voltage. Okay, that is 450 volt. So then the voltage across one phase and neutral is called the phase voltage. That is, in domestic purpose, we are using the 230 voltage DC supply, AC supply. That is an example, right? And then, so here, that voltage is called phase voltage. So the majority of students doubt. So then what is the difference between line voltage and phase voltage? So the voltage between two phases called phase voltage? No. The voltage between one phase and neutral is called a phase voltage. And the voltage between two phases is called a line voltage. And here in this circuit diagram, the voltmeter reading is VL. That is the no load line voltage. It's a rated value. So we are up the no load test. Applying rated voltage at a no load condition. And the ammeter reading is I0, and that is equal to no load line current in ampere. So it's a very small current. It is in the range of 1 ampere, 2 ampere, etc. compared to their rated current. Okay. It's wattmeter reading. So the sum of the, we are using a 2 wattmeter, then take the sum W1 plus W2. For a single wattmeter, so then that wattmeter reading W into 3. So that is the total power. So now this voltage is per phase, and the machine is a star connected, and Vp is equal to VL by root 3. So then you are already studied, the students are already studied in the basic electrical engineering, the relation between voltage and current in a star connected network. In a star connected network, the line voltage is equal to the root 3 times phase voltage. So that means our supply voltage, the domestic supply voltage is 230. So that is Vp. Vp is equal to 230. Then how will you calculate the line value? VL. So that VL is equal to this root 3 times 230. So that is our line value. And this is for star connected network. But the current is same. The current is same for all phases. So in the resistance measurements, we are already connected voltmeter across the two phases. Then current is flows through R to Y, then back to DC source. Same way, the same current is flows through in a star connected network. So then we are taking this current as no load current is I0. Zero means no load. Is equal to IL. IL means not a line, it is sorry, not a load, it is a line current, and that is equal to IP. IP means it is a phase current. Any doubt in this slide? Next is the no load power input per phase. Again, the same equation is applicable to the three phase power. Our power equation is, we can use the two powers, the line power and the phase power. Then using a line voltage and line current equation is, what is the equation? Root 3 VL IL cos phi. So we are using phase voltage. Then the equation is 3 Vp Ip cos phi. So both are same. First one is P is equal to root 3 VL IL cos phi is all the values are in line. Line values, and the second one is all are in phase values. From this equation, the P0 is already obtained from the 2 watt meter. Vp, that is the rated voltage. That is the voltmeter. Ip. Ip means it is IL, that is equal to I0, no load current. That is taken from the ammeter, which is connected in series with the machine. So in this equation, P0 is non-value, Vp is non-value, Ip is non-value, and the unknown value is cos phi. So then we can directly easily calculate, substitute value of P is here, P is a constant, Vp value from the voltmeter reading per phase, and Vp is substitute. So we can write the no load power factor is equal to P0 divided by 3 Vp into Ip. Clear? So the no load, we get the no load power factor. So then what is your aim? To find the constants R0 and X0. That means the magnetizing component of current and working component of. Okay. So for that, I am is from using this no load power I0. This I0 can be resolved into two components. I0 can be resolved into two components means I0 is a vector. Right? So this I0 is resolved into two components. That is, I0 is equal to square root of I0 square cos square phi plus I0 square sine square phi. So I0 is common factor, then taken outside, then cos square plus sine square, that is 1. Again, root of I0 square is I0. So that means the isomer can be resolved into two components. That means I0 sin phi 0 is one part and I0 cos phi 0. And IM is called, it is a magnetizing component of current. I0 is called a magnetizing component of current. Magnetizing component means, what is magnetizing component? So that will depends on the flux. So the paper condition motto, the rotating magnetic field, the magnitude of rotating magnetic field is always constant. Right? So that already studied in the first section, means the construction principle of operation in that time you already studied. So here, so IM is the magnetizing component of current, so that is a part of I0. Okay, that is I0 sin phi 0 is called a reactive component of no load current, and IW is called, IW is equal to I0 cos phi 0. I0 cos phi 0, that is called the active component of current. Okay, the active component of current is, that is the working component. Then what is our aim? To find the constant. How will we find the constant? So the constants are R0 and X0. R0 is equal to this VP. VP means our phase voltage divided by the working component of current, IW, that is I0 cos phi 0. Then we get to the constant R0. And the second one is X0. X0 is equal to Vp by Im. Im is the reactive component of no load current. So then we get the two equivalent circuit parameter constant. And this is, how will you connect this R0 and X0, or how will you draw this R0 and X0 in the circuit, in our circuit, in our equivalent circuit? Listen, here, what is the equation of R0? Vp. Vp by Iw. Second one is, X0 is again Vp by Im. So then, R is equal to V by I. So that means it is an Ohm's law. Equation equivalent to Ohm's law. So the voltage is constant. Vp is constant and divided by current. So current in through the resistance. Again, next part, Vp is constant and divided by current. So then listen, R0 and X0, Vp is constant. Vp is constant. That is, Vp is connected common to both R0 and X0. And what is the different? What is the different? Different one? Different one is the current flow. Current flow through R0 and X0. Right? So then, well, how we are locating this R0 and X0 in the circuit? So Vp is constant and current is different. That is voltage constant, current difference. And which circuit having this voltage is constant and current is different? Series circuit or parallel circuit? In a parallel circuit, voltage constant, current different. In each branch, current is varying. But in a series circuit, voltage is different, current is same. So now in this circuit, the voltage is same and current is varying. That means R0 and X0 having this same voltage, but they are carrying different current. That means R0 and X0 both are in parallel. Clear? Both are in parallel. Then how it is connected? Look. So this is the equivalent circuit obtained from which one? No load test. So here, R0 and X0, Vp is the input voltage, that is the same for R0, that is same for X0, and Iw and Imu, and another name of Im is called as Imu, both are same. Iw and Imu, the sum of Iw and Imu is or IM is equal to I0. Then what is R1 and X1? R1 is the stator resistance that is already calculated by using voltmeter ammeter method. And X1, X1 is how will you get this X1 that will that will today itself. And now R1, X1, and the remaining portion means of this circuit obtained from which one? Obtained from this null load. Okay, so then any doubt in this null load test, students?
No, ma'am, we can carry on.
Okay. So the next one is Broker water test. So then this block rotor test is almost same as that of the short circuit test of a transformer. Then what is the procedure for short circuit test of a transformer? All the meters are connected to which side? It is LV side or HV side? It is connected to block rotor test. It is connected to HV side and LV side is short circuited. Okay, then apply rated voltage, rated current, and then measure all the or take all the readings same way. So here this is analogous to the short circuit test of a transformer. And then the rotor field is held stationary and the rotor windings are short circuited. That means the rotor is in blocked condition. And a reduced voltage means our three phase voltage is, example, our three phase voltage is 400 voltage and reduced voltage of 15 to 20% means it is 60 to 80 volt is applied. So applied to the stator. So then the reduced voltage is applied, the rated current is flows through the machine. And what is the reason? So we are blocking the rotor. That means the load is fully given to the rotor. There is no rotation. Rotor is stationary. Right. So then it is tightly blocked. Then this at reduced voltage, it produces a rated current. And then in this experiment, we can measure its voltage, current, and power by using the same procedure as that of null load test. And this is the circuit diagram. So in the previous diagram, we are applying a rated voltage, but here it is a variable voltage. Variable voltage means the voltage is in the range of 60 to 80. That means 15 to 20% of voltage is applied to the stator. Then the machine carries a current at a rated value. Then here two wattmeter to measure the power. So this two wattmeter gives the copper loss of the machine. Okay, and this is the circuit diagram, and here the rotor is completely blocked. And here the procedure already told. So then one more thing is block condition. a small voltage is required to produce the rated current. Small voltage means it is in the 80 or 60 voltage that is required to produce the rated current. Then how will you calculate the rated current from the machine? The machine rating, KVA rating is already given. So from that rating, we can easily calculate the rated current. That is KVA divided by, it is V short circuit line voltage divided by root 3. Okay. And the short circuit phase current, ISCP is equal to ISEL. So that means the machine is a star connected machine. Line current is equal to phase current. And the power is TSE, short circuit power. And that short circuit power is equal to 3 into VSCP, ISCP, cos phi SC. Cos phi SC means power factor at the short circuit condition. That means the block rotor condition. So this total power gives the copper loss of the three phase induction motor. Right? The copper loss is I square R loss. So here it is the notation. One new term is coming, that is R01. That is 3 ISC square SCP ISCP square R01. Where R01 equal to R1 plus R2 dash. So in DCMT, you are already studied, then the resistance transferred to primary, resistance transferred to secondary, and the secondary resistance transferred to primary. Here, R1 is the stator resistance, R2 is the rotor resistance. So now we are connecting all the meters in the stator side. That means this is an armature circuit. That is equivalent to the primary of a transformer. And the rotor is completely blocked. Okay. And then the rotor resistance is transferred to the rotor to stator. So that is R2 dash. So then R01 equal to R1 plus R2 dash. Similarly, in the case of transformer, R02 means it is R2 plus R1 dash. So here the suffix 01 from secondary to primary. So that is represented R suffix 01. That is equal to the stator resistance plus the rotor transferred from stator, rotor to stator. Clear? And the short circuit power is equal to same equation of a power. Cos phi SC is equal to PSC divided by 3 VSCP ISCP. Or the equivalent resistance transferred to stator is equal to PSC divided by 3 ISCP square by using the first power equation. Clear? And the ratio of the short circuit voltage to the rated current, that is VSCP and ISCP are the 60 to 80%, that is 15 to 20% voltage and the rated current obtained from the block rotor test, and the ratio gives the total impedance. That means it is a combination, the machine is the combination of resistance and inductance, then we get the total impedance of Z01. So R01 is already calculated from where? From using the copper loss or power equation. From that equation, we can easily calculate which one? X01, the reactance of the stator, that is X01 equal to square root of Z02 square minus R01 square. So that means it's using an impedance triangle. Now, impedance triangle is that the Rx, that R is parallel to X axis, X is perpendicular to y axis, and then it is a right angle triangle. So then the third side is the base, altitude and hypotenuse. Hypotenuse is z and r is base and altitude is x. And the same equation is used here. Okay. So then from that equation, we can write the equation of x01 is equal to x1 plus x2 dash. X1 means it is the inductance of primary plus x2 dash, it is the inductance of secondary. Okay. Secondary, not secondary, it is also referred to stator. So then normally the stator and rotor reactance per phase is assumed to be constant. So we are assuming that the inductance of stator and rotor is almost the same. So then we are taking the half. So then half, then that is equal to x0 1/2. So then r01 is already calculated. It's equal to r1 plus r2 dash. And then r1 is measured by using voltmeter, ammeter method. So now we are calculated r01 and r1 by using the short circuit test and resistance measurement technique. So then from that equations we can easily calculate the rotor resistance. So then the reduced voltage, the magnetizing part is eliminated and the remaining term is displayed here. And this equivalent circuit is the equivalent circuit of a block rotor test, that is r1, x1, r2 dash and x2 dash. Means it is actually a rotor resistance which is transferred to stator. Okay, the secondary is transferred to or primary of the transformer. Similar way, we are transferring the rotor resistance and the reactance to the stator. Any doubt?
Ma'am, we have a doubt. Why? What is the idea behind blocking the rotor and measuring power?
What is the idea?
Idea Pardon? Behind blocking the rotor and measuring power.
So the idea behind the blocking the rotor means, so this experiment is done at the full load condition. The full load condition means for that we are completely block the rotor. Otherwise, so block the rotor means in experimental side, in a lab setup, we are blocking means we are tightening the brake drum or hold the brake drum portion. Okay, so that is in that way we are completely block the circuit. So then we want to apply the rated current. And then in a transformer test, short circuit test, the secondary is completely short circuited. Similar way, so that is equivalent to this machine case, we are block or hold the rotor of a three phase induction machine for getting the rated current. That means the machine is tightly loaded. Any other doubt?
Okay, ma'am. Why there is no magnetizing effect under low voltage?
Low voltage, actually, so the one magnet is there, and this magnet is completely magnetized when you are applying a full voltage. So then, best example is the hysteresis loop of a hysteresis loop. So then, in a hysteresis loop, we are magnetizing the core, and then it is demagnetizing. We get this loop, hysteresis loop. Or the core is fully magnetized, apply the rated voltage and additional 25 voltage is applied to get fully magnetized. To get a full magnetization, additional 25 volt. That means suppose the machine is a 400 voltage rated machine. To get a full magnetization, additional 25 volt. That means 25% of 400 is 100. Then 400 plus 100 is 500. The 500 voltage is required to fully magnetize the core. So compared to that one, the 60 or 80 is very, very small. So then the core is just 1% is, or 1 or 2% is excited. The remaining portion is fully vacant. So we didn't get enough magnetization in that particular core. Clear?
Okay, ma'am. How to separate R1 and R2?
R1 and R2. So R1 is already calculated by using the determination of the stator resistance. Right? So first one, the three tests are required for calculating the equivalent circuit. First one is determination of stator resistance. In that experiment, we get R1, small letter R suffix 1. Small letter R2 is obtained from the block rotor test. In a block rotor test, we get the equivalent of these two, equivalent of R1 and R2, R2 dash. That is, so listen, in this the present slide, so R1, it is the sum of the stator of the rotor resistance, which is transferred to the stator. The, what is the reason for adding this R2 directly? Why we are adding this R2 adding directly to the equation? So it is R2 dash. Why? So because this R2, the rotor is in the low voltage range. So then we cannot add a high voltage and a low voltage directly. So then the stator is at the high voltage level. It is a 400 voltage level. And suppose the rotor is in the low voltage range, then the value of R2 we get at the 60 or 80 volts. That is not added to 400 voltage range resistance value. So we want to convert the low range resistance into equivalent high value. For that, it is converted to the equivalent base of 400. That is R2 dash. R1 is already obtained from the determination of stator resistance measurement. R01 is obtained from the block rotor test, and this R1 is deducted from R01, we get R2 dash. Okay. That is the last equation. Okay. So then, this is the equivalent circuit obtained from the block rotor test. Now R2 dash, H2 dash, and R1 X is already there. So, value is from the system. ES is the voltage, 60 or 80 volt. Okay. Then next step is adding the equivalent circuit that is obtained in the no load test to the equivalent circuit obtained from the block rotor test. The branch one is R0 and X0 added to the second one. How it is? This one, clear? So then the first section is the value obtained from the no load test, and the second part is, second part means after R1, so that is obtained from the block rotor test, and then combining these two equivalent circuits, then we get the final equivalent circuit of a three phase induction motor. So that is R1 stator resistance and reactance. Second one is R2 dash and X2 dash. Rotor resistance and stator reactance referred to primary and secondary. And the last one is R2 dash by S into 1 minus S is the load resistor. That is the resistance obtained from the output side, that is the load side. So then we can calculate the value of R2 by S into 1 minus S into I2 square gives the total power, output power of the machine. So here we are using the RL. Instead of RL, we are using R2 dash by S into 1 minus S. So then how will you get this value? It is obtained from the input and output power of the rotor. Input power is already known. That is, the input power equation of the rotor is I2 square R2 by S. And the rotor copper loss is I2 square R2. And from the input, the losses are deducted. We get the output. So the machine rotor input is there. Losses is there. And how much amount of loss that is deducted from the input, we get the output. Okay. So then finally, we get the equation of the losses of that is the power output is I2 square R2 into 1 minus S by S. So here in that case, R2 by S into 1 minus S means it is a load of capital RL. Okay, so now R1, R2 dash is the two resistors. X1 and X2 dash is the another two reactances. So connected together. R1 plus R2 dash is already told you it is R01, right? Similarly, we can write X, in this slide, the second line, X01 is equal to X1 plus X2 dash. So combining these two, we get the final equivalent circuit that is called the approximate equivalent circuit of induction motor. So that DP voltage and the first branch is obtained from which one? It is a no load test, and the remaining one combining R01 is combining resistance of stator resistance and rotor resistance. X01 is the stator reactance and the rotor reactance. So then I2 dash is the rotor current, RL is the load resistance. And combining all these, we get this final equivalent circuit. Any doubt?
Ma'am, there is a question. What does X2 dash signify in the equivalent circuit?
Starting time of the session. Okay, so then the how will we get this value? So for that we are conducting this experiment. So here in the what is this X2 dash signify in the equivalent circuit? Actually, the rotor circuit consisting of it is rotor winding is there. It's a actually it is a field circuit. And in the rotor circuit, it is resistance and reactance is there. And then this X2 dash is, means the X2 is there, then we are connecting it into the, it is completely blocked. So it's a full effect is included into the power, in the total power equations. That is, not power equations, it is completely the effect of rotor resistance and inductance are included into the machine performance.
Is the rotor leakage reactance is referred to? X2 dash is the rotor.
Ma'am, our allotted time is over. Can we wind up the session now, ma'am?
Okay, okay.
We will mail the rest of the questions to you, ma'am.
Yeah, definitely. My mail ID is already given. So here, if you have any doubt, just send me mail.
Okay, ma'am. We'll send all the rest of the questions to your mail, and we'll add it in the transcript, ma'am.
Hello. Okay. Okay.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And thank you for all for joining today. Thank you.